Good morning.
Morning.
How's everybody doing today? So I have a quick live announcement that did not make it into their pre-recorded announcements that you'll see here in a second. I just, first off, I wanted to thank everybody who came last Sunday to Pastor Young's going away celebration. I think it went really well. We had a great turnout. What did I say? No, I'm sorry, Pastor June's. I'm getting ahead of myself. No. So Pastor June's going away. So it was great. I want to thank everybody that came and donated food and helped and all that. So thank you very much. So the next celebration is next Sunday when we'll be welcoming our new pastor, Pastor Young, to our church. So we're going to have a special service that Spike has written, and I'll be assisting him with next Sunday. Pastor Young will be here. He will be doing communion. We'll have some welcoming gifts for him, and we'll have a special welcoming ceremony, coffee hour, basically, afterwards, for you to get to know him a little bit better and get to meet him. So if you're able and free, please come next Sunday. Thank you.
Welcome to Breakfast Church at Great Hill for Sunday, June 27th, 2021. Thank you to Joe Andriana for bringing us the message today, as well as members of the Breakfast Church team for helping in the service. We are looking for help for the July 13th Spooner House meal. Maury Ward will be providing some watermelons for dessert, but we still need a main course and side dishes. Currently, there are 15 residents who receive our contributed meal. If you can supply any portion of the dinner, please contact Maury Ward. The Seymour Oxford Food Bank's wish list for June includes chicken, chili, hash, stew, manwich, and Vienna sausages. Donations can be left in the fellowship hall in the entryway near the church office. The worship committee will be meeting this afternoon to work out our plans for worship during the summer months. We will send out an email with specifics later this week. We are working towards resuming worship in the sanctuary. We expect that for the summer months, we will not be using Zoom for a fellowship time or to watch the service. But we will still be recording and posting the worship service to YouTube each week. If you have questions or concerns, please contact Spike or Betty. I invite Betty and Shelby to begin our service by bringing in the light of Christ.
Let us now bring the light of Christ into our places of worship.
Before I begin our call to worship, I want to recognize someone who's joining us today. We have with us today Pastor Jane and Bob Sibley. I've often introduced Pastor Jane as being the Holy Spirit. And the reason I use that term is that when she was our pastor, she burned my rear several times. But I am so pleased that they are here with us today. I would ask you now, if you would, to join me in our call to worship. Lord, come into our hearts today. Lord, come into our lives today. Come, Let us worship God who brings hope and peace. Please join me now in our opening unison prayer. Lord of healing and mercy, remind us again of your power to heal our lives from fears and mistrust. Open our hearts to believe in your restorative power and your great compassion for us. Give us healing and make us agents of peace for you in this, your world. Amen.
A reading from the New Testament, 2 Corinthians 8, 7 through 15. Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by the completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. The gospel lesson from the Mark 5, 21 through 43. A girl restored to life and a woman healed. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came up, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all she had. And she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt her body, that she had been healed of the disease. Immediately aware that the power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all aside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in to where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk. She was about 12 years old. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Spike. Spike asked Peter if he would time the gospel to see if the gospel was longer than my message this morning. A couple weeks ago, when Faith asked me if I would deliver the message today, I quickly responded and said yes, and I promised her that I would be brief. Now, having said that, I look out and I can almost hear you thinking, Joe's definition of brief is different than my definition of brief, but I promise you, I will be brief. Let me begin by defining some words. The first is the word sermon. And Webster defines sermon as a speech on conduct or duty, which is pretty high level. The second word is message. Message is defined as an underlying theme or idea. A little less than a sermon, but still pretty high level. And the third is the word conversation, an oral exchange of opinions. And that's the term that I am most comfortable with, an oral exchange of ideas. But if you have a conversation, it suggests that there have to be two people. And there is two people. This morning, I am Joseph. And Joseph's role is to help explain the meaning of today's gospel. That's Joseph. I'm also Joe, and Joe's mission is to tell you how the gospel can relate to your everyday life. I need to go back and become Joseph again. In the gospel that you heard, many people came to Jesus and asked for help. And that's important because they asked for help. You heard also that a woman came and touched Jesus' coat. And people wondered, what would that be? Well, Jesus responded to that woman. He said, "Your faith has made you well," and she was made well. And then she also heard about synagogue week. And during the course of the gospel, we're told that his daughter had died. And several other people in the synagogue says, "Why are you bothering with this guy? Your daughter is dead. Don't bother Jesus." But that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said to the synagogue leader, "Do not fear, only believe." A lesson for all of us. Do not fear, only believe. Then Jesus went to the synagogue leader's house and found, as you heard, a commotion and weeping. But Jesus said to them, "This child is not dead. She's just sleeping." And he uttered those words which translated to, "Little girl, get up." And she did. But then Jesus went on to say, "Don't tell everyone about this." And to me, what that means is Jesus is saying to all of us, what I do is important, but I don't do it simply because it's important. I don't do it so that you can praise me. I don't do it so that you can tell everybody what I have done. Those are a few words to describe a very, very long and complex gospel. I think it's time now for Joe to come back up and begin to tell us a little bit more about what this means to us as members of Great Hill United Methodist Church. And in order to do that, there are several words I think they caught Joe's attention. The first phrase, "ask for help." The second word, "faith." The third was the phrase, "do not fear." And then the last, "tell no." Why do these words or phrases mean anything to Joe? Well, I think they mean a lot to Joe, and hopefully they mean a lot to you as well. Why? First of all, it says you must ask for God's help. How do we do that? Well, the simplest way is simply through our prayers. And they don't have to be the formal prayers that we often
recite. Sometimes words that flow from our mouth, but which we really don't think a lot about. It could be just a simple request of you talking to God. But the important thing is you're asking for God's help. Your faith in God is needed because we often do not understand what and why God is acting. It would be wonderful for all of us, certainly me included, if we had an idea in advance what God is going to do for us. But that doesn't happen very often. And sometimes we don't realize what God has done for us until God has already done it. And then you think back and say, how did that happen? Or why did that happen? And if you think about it, more often than not, it's because God made it happen. And lastly, your faith will overcome your fear. We're living in a difficult time, you say. For some of us, it's getting a little bit brighter, but still, I'd be the first one to admit to you that the past months have created a great deal of fear. I had fear for my family, and I had fear for myself. I'm of an age that says if I were to get sick, I could get really sick. And that frightened me. But what does God say? God says, Joe, have faith in me, and I'll take care of you. And I sit here today, months after I've been vaccinated, one of the advantages of being old, I guess, and God has taken care of me. In addition to that, God has taken care of my family. He's taken care of Pat. He's taken care of Gene. He's taken care of my son, Michael, and my daughter-in-law, Tracy. My grandson, Matt, his fiance, Brittany. He's taken care of all of us. And he has said again and again, your faith will overcome your fear. What actions should you or I take based upon today's gospel? Well, I would suggest that you ask and pray for God's help, even if you don't know exactly what you need. Now, that may seem a little strange. Say, well, wait a minute. How am I going to ask for God's help if I don't know really what I need? That's the beauty of God's unbounded love. You don't have to ask for anything specific. You could say, God, just take care of it. God will take care of it. The gospel also suggests that you and I need to pray for the sick and the less fortunate. That's something that this church does extremely well. Over the past couple of months, a good friend of mine lost his wife, 55 years old. But I had an opportunity to talk to him recently, and he felt calm. And I truly believe that he felt that way because we prayed our hearts out that Sue would recover. But as I said before, we don't always know what God has in mind. Sue did not recover, but Sue is in an awful good place now. And her husband, Steve, is in a good place also because of your prayers. And there is also one other thing that I would ask you to consider. This church has always been very strong in terms of their mission ministry. I sense in this church now one generation my generation is moving on, and the next generation that I see out there is moving in. And I would ask you specifically to think about what you could do to become part of Great Hills Mission Ministry. I think that's something that will benefit not only our church, but will also take care of those who are less fortunate than us to take care of. What lies ahead? And I say that in connection with today's gospel. Today, our faith, our conference, and our church is in the midst of a wilderness. We really don't know where to go, what direction to go, and more importantly, how we're going to get there. In addition to that, Great Hills is in the midst of a transition. As Bob indicated, Pastor Young will be joining us next week for the very first time. What can you do to help that transition be successful? Well, the first thing you can do is to assist Pastor Young as he begins to understand the community that he's assigned to serve. Bishop Bickerton, when he assigns a pastor, makes it a point of saying, I'm not assigning you to a church. I'm assigning you to a community that church serves. In this case, I would say that would be Seymour and Oxford. So we all have a role to play. We need to help Pastor Young be introduced to the community that he is going to serve. How can we do that? Well, simple example. I'm sure I could call the first selectman in Oxford and say, George, if you got 5 minutes, I'd like to bring my pastor down and introduce my new pastor to you. And I suspect that could happen. Pastor Young has to be introduced to our community leaders, to our educational structures, to our boards of education, to the agencies that protect us, our police, our fire department. And we have a role to play of introducing Pastor Young to all of those agencies. In addition to that, he needs to be introduced to the food bank and to the homeless shelter that we have supported for decades. I ask you again to pray for God's help, to help lead us out of this wilderness. And I ask you to pray and hold tight to our faith in God. God bless you all. Amen.
Amen.
That's about as beautiful as Amazing Grace could ever sound. Before I move into our pastoral prayers, I'd ask for a moment of silence in your prayers for the victims and families of the catastrophe that occurred in Surfside, Florida this past week. Thank you. Let us pray. Healing Lord, there are so many situations we have encountered which require healing and restoration. We try to do the best we can, but we cannot rely on our own strength and skills to bring about the complete healing that is so desperately needed. Help us to place our trust in you. Help us to work effectively to promote situations of healing and hope. We have come before you with so many concerns in our hearts. There seems to be no end to the desperate needs of your people, O Lord. Yet you love and hear all of us as we pray. You surround us with your love and healing mercies. You lift us gently and give us courage to work for you in ministries of peace and love. We also pray specifically for the coronavirus to stop spreading and for all the people who have been infected with COVID-19, for their smooth continuation of the vaccination process. We also pray for all who work in healthcare. We pray for all teachers, students, and all the people working in our school systems. May they find a rest during the summer vacation. May those who need your love and watchfulness be fortified by your presence and be brought closer to you. We specifically pray for our friends, Joan Ford and Shirley Green. May they feel your presence and be connected with us. We also remember those who are hungry, for the homeless, for those suffering from emotional, mental, and spiritual hardship. And today we lift up these church families: Krista, Joseph, Kyla, DeCensisanto, Doris, Terry, Debashetko, Jennifer Dumas, Pam, Stephanie, and Brandon Ellsworth, and Joan and Gary Ford. Loving and merciful God, we ask that you would be with us and all the people we have named, and even those that were unnamed in our hearts. We thank you and pray in the name of Christ, who gathered us and taught us the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Beloved of God, healed and forgiven, blessed and strengthened, go forth to be a blessing to others, proclaiming the love and mercy of God in all that you do and say. Amen.
Though the light of the candle may end, the light that is Christ remains with us always.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I just want to hope I catch people. We do have a few people watching on Zoom, and I only got to speak to one of them before we actually started the service, so I hope everybody on Zoom is still watching. But I wanted to let you guys know, you know, these last months during COVID, you know, have been a trial for all of us in a bunch of different ways. And for the church family, it's been, as Peter and I are now fond of saying, a huge experiment. Everything we have done has been experimental. Some of it has worked, some of it hasn't. You know, when we first started doing the AV stuff, we used Zoom. We recorded different parts on Thursday nights, and we, you know, Peter stitched them all together, and, you know, we gave you the YouTube videos to watch. And as we were doing that, for anybody who was involved in doing that, thank you so much. But you will know that we just could not keep a straight face sometimes. You know, and something that was supposed to take, you know, 45 minutes to an hour, you know, for service would take slightly more than that, because we just, you know, we would flub things up. And, you know, our church has always been forgiving on a Sunday morning about flubs, but somehow we skipped over that. We went right for perfection, which sometimes makes it worse. And we would start to tease each other about, you know, we really need to put a blooper reel together, because if anybody else saw this, they would just burst out laughing, and they would love it. And this week, when Betty and Shelby made their candle lighting, they had some blooper stuff happening. And when Shelby said, you know, it's still up there, I thought you'd enjoy it, I immediately emailed her back. I said, is it okay if we show this? So she said yes. So Peter is going to run what the raw footage of the candle lighting and blessing.
Okay. Let us now bring the light of Christ into our places of worship. Okay. Stop it. Stop, hold on. Don't.
Okay.
Though the light of the candle may end. Keep it going, keep it going.
Okay.
Try again.
Everyone just close their eyes. Stop. Stop.
All right. Okay. Should I start a new one?
No. This is good. Peter needs bloopers. Okay, just wiping the tears.
I'm gonna pause it, right?
No.
I'm good.
Okay.
It's done.
All right, just make sure you let them know.
Okay, everyone, stop. This is serious.
All right, let's do it.
Okay. Though the light of the candle may end.
This is great.
I'm sweating.
Do I stop it or not?
No, it's fine.
Oh my goodness. Just tell him, I'll tell him the timestamp, all right? We're at 2 minutes and 20 seconds
Thank
now.
Thank goodness.
2 minutes and 25 seconds.
Okay. Though the light of the candle may end.
I'm stopping.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to hope I catch people. We do have a few people watching on Zoom, and I only got to speak to one of them before we actually started the service, so I hope everybody on Zoom is still watching. But I wanted to let you guys know, you know, these last months during COVID, you know, have been a trial for all of us in a bunch of different ways. And for the church family, it's been, as Peter and I are now fond of saying, a huge experiment. Everything we have done has been experimental. Some of it has worked, some of it hasn't. When we first started doing the AV stuff, we used Zoom. We recorded different parts on Thursday nights, and we, you know, Peter stitched them all together, and you know, we gave you the YouTube videos to watch. And as we were doing that, for anybody who was involved in doing that, thank you so much. But you will know that we just could not keep a straight face sometimes. You know, and something that was supposed to take, you know, 45 minutes to an hour, you know, for service would take slightly more than that, because we just, you know, we would flub things up. And, you know, our church has always been forgiving on a Sunday morning about flubs, but somehow we skipped over that. We went right for perfection, which sometimes makes it worse. And we would start to tease each other about, you know, we really need to put a blooper reel together, because if anybody else saw this, they would just burst out laughing, and they would love it. And this week, when Betty and Shelby made their candle lighting, they had some blooper stuff happening. And when Shelby said, you know, it's still up there, I thought you'd enjoy it, I immediately emailed her back. I said, is it okay if we show this? So she said yes. So Peter is going to run, but the raw footage of the candle lighting and blessing